Penguin Random House Audio presents MeatEater, Adventures from the Life of an American Hunter. This is the author, Steven Rinella. For Matt and Danny, brothers and best friends. Chapter 1. Standing Ground. This book has a hell of a lot going for it simply because it's a hunting story. That's because hunting stories are the oldest and most widespread form of story on Earth. The genre has been around so long and has such deep roots that it extends beyond humans. When two wolves meet up, they'll often go through a routine of smelling each other's breath. For a wolf to put his nose to another wolf's mouth is to pose a question. What happened while you were hunting? To exhale is to answer. You can still smell the blood. Of course, nothing tells a hunting story like a human. Long ago, our ancestors may have told hunting stories in ways that are similar to those of animals today. It's been proposed that the human kiss finds its origins in a mouth-to-mouth greeting similar to that of the modern wolves. Similarly, it's been proposed that the handshake originated as a way of proving that neither party was concealing a weapon. But at some point, at least by 50,000 years ago, though possibly much earlier, we began to tell our hunting stories through the complex languages that are now a hallmark of our species. Linguists and anthropologists theorize that complex language evolved just for this purpose, to coordinate hunting and gathering activities, to categorize an increasingly complex arsenal of hunting tools and weapons, and to convey details about animals and habitat that might be hidden from sight. In short, language came about for the same purposes that I'm engaged in at this very moment. Granted, these first hunting stories were probably not stories at all, at least not in the way we now think of that word. I imagine them more as instructions and descriptions, which is fitting, since the purpose of the vast majority of writing about hunting today is to teach readers how to do something. This something can be quite esoteric. Maybe it's a technique for hunting mallard ducks over flooded corn in Iowa, or maybe it's an explanation of why it's better to sharpen the blade of your skinning knife at an angle of 13 degrees rather than 15. Hunters usually call this kind of information how-to, and I have read and enjoyed a great many pieces of how-to writing in my life. But while you will find a trove of hunting tips and tricks within this book, this is not intended as how-to material. Instead, you might think of this book as why-to, who-to, and what-to. That is, this book uses the ancient art of the hunting story to answer the questions of why I hunt, who I am as a hunter, and what hunting means to me. As I ponder the first of those questions, why do I hunt? Two particular moments come to mind. The first took place on a recent spring day when I was hunting turkeys in the Powder River Badlands of southeastern Montana with my brother Matt. Early that morning, we left Matt's pack llamas, Timmy and Haggy, tethered near our camp. Matt headed south, and I went into the next valley to the west. Around late morning, I started after a tom, or male turkey, that I'd heard gobbling several hundred yards away. I followed the bird for close to an hour, only once catching a glimpse of it. He was walking fast along the edge of a sandstone cliff, maybe about 30 yards higher than me and 200 yards out. I sat down amid a tangle of fallen timber and used a turkey call to mimic the soft clucks of a hen. Almost as soon as I did, the tom jumped off the cliff and took flight. He flapped his wings maybe six times and soared right over my head. Turkeys are not graceful flyers, nor are they graceful landers. This one crashed through the limbs of a ponderosa pine and then thudded to the ground on the timbered slope of a deep ravine off to my left. I turned my head in that direction so that my chin was over my left shoulder. I kept on clucking. I was hopeful that the tom would come to check on the source of the calls, but after a couple of minutes, I hadn't seen or heard a thing. I called some more, but still nothing happened. You have to be very careful about movement and sound when you're hunting turkeys, so I continued to hold dead still even though I hadn't heard or seen the bird since it landed. Maybe about 5 minutes went by without my ever turning my head away from its position over my left shoulder. And then something strange happened. Suddenly, someone sighed very loudly just behind my right shoulder. I've had coyotes and bobcats come to my turkey call, but this sigh sounded like that of an annoyed person who is slightly out of breath from running up a hill. My immediate response was to turn my head very quickly in its direction. My chin was just about to begin passing over my right shoulder when I noticed a large male black bear standing on its rear feet with its front feet propped up on a log that was leaning against the log that I was leaning against. I'm sure he was hoping to find a nest full of turkey eggs and, if everything went well, to catch the turkey too. Now he was staring at me with a very inquisitive look in his eye as he struggled to recalibrate his expectations. I once heard a radio interview with a neuroscientist who studies mental processes during extremely stressful moments. He described how people in such situations will recall having dozens of distinct thoughts in the seconds that it takes for, say, a person that has fallen from a roof to hit the ground. His belief, he explained, is that we aren't actually having those thoughts when we think we are. Rather, through a trick of memory, we just think we had them whenever we try to recall the moment. Regardless of what that guy says, I know that I had the following thoughts over the course of the next second or so. I thought about how weird it was that this bear and I both happened to be hunting turkeys in the same place at the same time. And I thought about how weird it was that I was trying to deceive a turkey in order to kill it and eat it, and how my efforts to do so had in turn deceived another creature that would have liked to have killed and eaten that turkey as well. And I wondered what effect my turkey gun, a 12-gauge shotgun loaded with copper-coated number 5 pellets, would have on a black bear at close range. And I imagined myself making a case for self-defense when I was investigated by a game warden for killing a black bear without the proper permit. And I imagined what it would be like to get mauled by a black bear. And if I did get mauled, I imagined that it would be very minor mauling, as the bear would quickly realize that I wasn't what he was after. And then I thought about how black bears hardly ever mess with people. And then I imagined myself telling this story for a very long time, regardless of the actual outcome. The bear interrupted this whirlwind litany of thoughts with a woof, like the first noise a dog might make when someone knocks at the door. He then ran off through the timber at the casual pace of a jogging human. The sound of the bear's running died away, and the forest returned to its usual crisp and breezy stillness. I leaned back to wait for my pulse to slow, as it was racing at a speed that I figured to be unhealthy. I sat for maybe 5 minutes, just breathing and thinking. I had that grateful and relieved feeling that you get when you first realize that you're recovering from the flu. Then I heard a turkey gobble, so far away and faint that the sound seemed more like a feeling than an actual noise. I got up to look for it, happy to be alive and walking in this wonderful and ancient world where bears sigh and turkeys gobble. The second moment that helps answer the question of why I hunt occurred well over 2,000 miles to the north of where I was hunting turkeys. I was camped on the north slope of Alaska's Brooks Range, about 75 miles south of the Arctic Ocean's Beaufort Sea. I'd been there for a week, waiting for the arrival of caribou. I hadn't intended to stay so long, and I was running low on food. This was worrying me just as the sound of food came by. I was lying in my sleeping bag during the first moments of morning light, and the noise I heard was a rush of wings so close to my tent that the nylon quivered. It was followed by the strange cackling of ptarmigan, a grouse-like bird that is bigger than a quail but smaller than a pheasant. My brother Danny has heard their call described as "go back, go back, go back," but it reminds me more of Curly's signature laugh from the Three Stooges, a sort of nyak, nyak, nyak. My boots were frozen, but I pulled them on as best as I could and stepped out to a gravel bar that was crusted in frost. I dragged a rubberized duffel bag out from under my flipped-over canoe, grabbed a 20-gauge shotgun in one hand and a handful of shells in the other, and trotted off in the direction that the birds had gone. I crossed the ice of a small pond, formed where a braid of the river had become isolated from the main channel. It was almost frozen to the bottom, and I could see a small school of sticklebacks biding their time inside a doomed world.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.